June 4th. That Saturday, June 4th, break every chain on the square, First Baptist Church, that will be in the block down at the new Life Center. Starts at 1 o'clock, hamburger hot dogs, Selena's giving testimony. We'll be there with our youth material, it'll be a good opportunity for outreach, to reconnect with some of our youth students that haven't been here in a while, to invite some folks to go participate. It's just a good time, be good music, testimonies, like I said, hamburger hot dogs, all that sort of stuff. And so we need to be there, need to use that as an outreach. That's 1 o'clock, June 4th. Selena will be going in for surgery on Wednesday, June 1st. So remember that, I got it on my calendar to send out a reminder for prayer early that morning.
It'll be there early in the morning, yes.
I'm up early.
It's scheduled for 7:30.
I'll wait till a little later before I send the text out, but some folks don't pay attention to it that early in the morning, so.
Yeah, I don't get any texts.
No.
No?
I said, if I can find out why you're not on the list. All right, 6 procedures for pleading God. We're going on into chapter 6. Last week we finished up talking about 5 forms for a firm foundation, and I'll say it once again, I say it about every chapter. That's one of my favorites. 5 form for a firm foundation, that was one of my favorites. 6 procedures for pleasing God. Now let's dissect and define just a little bit. Procedures. What's a procedure?
An established method.
Steps you take, a method you put. And you know one of the biggest reasons why we struggle in our Christian walk? It's a procedural error. You ever heard anybody say that? It's a procedural error. If something fails or something happens at work and production is not met, or a piece comes out as subpar, or something is rejected from inspection, a lot of times it's a procedural error.
Yeah.
That means that one step in that method may have gotten missed. Now, that'll always mean that something is unfit. It just simply means it's not of the right quality to meet a certain standard. So procedure means taking those steps, that established method. And one of the greatest failures, like I started to say, we have in our Christian walk is many times is a procedural error, if that makes sense to you. We skip a step, or we don't follow the method, or we don't follow, and here's the word that we like to use, the discipline.
Yeah.
That word disciple comes from a root word that means discipline, which means a regimented method, or a procedure, or a step that we follow. And so discipleship means, being discipled means that we follow the steps, the instructions, the procedure, the method of whom we're following. Because we know by trusting Christ as our Savior, we're following Jesus Christ. And there is a method, there's a procedure, there's a discipline that we go through to achieve that victorious Christian life. Amen. And many times some of the reasons why we fail is a procedural error. We might want to skip a step, or we leave out a process. And to tie that into what our principle was for tonight, great little compromises lead to great disaster, the little sins lead to great sin. When we skip a little step, our procedure gets out of line. And then our discipline begins to fail. And before we know it, that little step that we skip, getting up this early, and this 30 minutes extra in the morning to get this daily devotion read, or, just reading that principle for today, or reading that chapter in Proverbs, I can skip that. That's okay. That's part of the procedure, part of the discipline of a victorious Christian life, but we kind of let that step slip aside. And then what happens? We begin to fall apart. That compromise leads to a disaster. That little sin leads to a big sin. We have to follow the procedure. We have to follow the step. It's just like when we talk about the formula for freedom. And we base that on John 8:32. Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, that's the first step of the formula, first part of the process, the procedure, believing on Jesus Christ. You continue in my word, that means we continue in that Bible study, following after Jesus. Then you shall know the truth. The Holy Spirit will come and help explain the truth of God's word to us, and guess what? Then you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. It's a formula. It's a recipe. And once we find out what the recipe is, once we find out what the procedure is, or procedures are, we don't need to skip those steps, because we don't come out with the same product or an inferior product. Now, the lesson says six procedures, but there's not just, if you do these six things, you will make God happy. Well, it'd be easy if we could do that. We'd say, oh, I can do those six things, then I'll be perfectly in line with God. Well, what about 10 commandments? There's 10 things, just a few more than six. Oh, if I just do those 10 things, that'd be perfectly, well, we know how hard that is.
Mm-hmm.
But the whole point that the lesson is trying to make, that there are a method, there's procedures, there's steps to follow. And if we'll follow these steps, it'll be pleasing to God. So it's a method or procedure, a series of steps. And notice what else he says in that. Furthermore, we beseech you, brethren, exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that ye have received of us how ye ought to walk. Now, when it says how ye ought to walk, you know what that says to me? Procedure, method. This is how you're going to do it. And to please God. And then he says, so ye would abound more and more. Abound. That word abound.
Over.
Means overflow. That's right. It means above and beyond. You know, we don't just want to be a hanging on, just getting by the skin of our teeth Christian. We want to abound. Well, what does that mean? We want God's favor in our life. We want God's blessing on our life. We want to be fulfilled in God, that we want to be used for His purposes. That's what it means to abound. So these steps, this method, this process, these procedures that we can follow to please God will help us abound more and more in Him. And by the way, why? What's the benefits of pleasing God? What's the benefits?
Spiritual blessings, like
blessings,
protection,
prayer
and obedience.
His presence in our life.
Protection.
Yeah.
His blessing on our life. His favor in our life. What about His protection in our life?
I said that.
Yeah.
Did you say that?
Three times.
Sorry, I didn't hear you. I couldn't hear from my own self talking. That's one of the things that I'm grateful to God for more than anything else, is His protection.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, it's a rough world we live in. I'm grateful for His protection. I'm grateful and thankful and for His peace in my life.
Oh, I love the peace.
Boy, if we please God, that means we're at peace with Him. What's the Bible say in the book of Romans? How can two walk together unless they be agreed? So you walk in and you go in the same direction with God, you're pleasing Him. You got peace with Him. I don't want to butt heads with God. I butt heads with people enough, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm always swimming against the current, you know? Oh, I said I'm like a lightning rod. Any kind of confrontation around, any kind of conflict, I'm going to be right in the middle of it. I want to be at peace with God, though. I don't have to be fighting against God all the time. I want to be going the same way God's going.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah.
So as we start into this lesson, into these six procedures, and we won't get to any of them without time to get the introduction done, let's look at what it says there in Hebrews chapter 11, talking about Moses. Moses chose to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Now, already right there, there's a versus going on. You know, we live in a world of versus. You know what I'm talking about? Good versus bad.
Yeah.
Light versus darkness. God versus Satan. It's always that. We always got to make that choice. We always got to. And so right there we see, it said that Moses chose to suffer the afflictions with his people and enjoy pleasures of sin. What does it mean to enjoy the pleasures of sin?
Indulging in it.
What?
Indulging in it.
Indulging in it. Is sin easy?
Yes.
Yeah.
Very easy. Is living for God hard?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mainly it's hard because we still live in the fleshly body that we were born in. So we're in constant battle against the flesh. But sin's easy. Sin's very easy. And so, but Moses said, I had rather be with my people than his people were under affliction. You know, Moses in Exodus, that Moses and the Hebrews, the Israelites, they were under the thumb of Pharaoh. They worked for him. They made mortar and bricks and blocks and building material for Pharaoh. They were slaves. And they were afflicted. Afflicted means more than sometimes we think about afflicted. We picture in our mind's eye someone who has some sort of physical impairment or disability. And that's true. But they were afflicted in another matter as well. They weren't allowed to worship their God as they wanted to. They were afflicted. They were physically mistreated. They didn't have enough food and water. They were afflicted. Moses said, I had rather endure the afflictions of my people than I had enjoy the pleasures of sin. Now, why could Moses say that? Because Moses was born into royalty. You know the story again from the book of Genesis and Exodus. Moses put him in a little basket in the river so that he wouldn't be killed as all the babies, but Pharaoh had ordered all the babies, and he floated down the river in that little basket. And Pharaoh's daughter found him, one of the handmaids did, and brought him to, and she took that baby, Moses, as her own, and raised him in the very seat of royalty. He sat right next to the Pharaoh. He knew all of the grandeur and all of the opulence and all of the privilege of being Pharaoh's child, so to speak, grandchild, child. So he knew what it was like to be in that world, which was sinful. Why was it sinful? Because it was not of God. There was nothing. I mean, even though it was all beautiful and opulent and service and grandeur and splendor and all of that, it was still sinful. Because they didn't worship God. They worshiped all sorts of different gods. One of the greatest gods, one of the favorite gods of the Pharaohs, the Egyptian people, was the god Ra, which was the god of the sun. And they worshiped that god. So he was sinful. But he chose, rather than live in the pleasures of sin, meaning he had all he ever wanted to eat, he didn't have to worry about where he was going to lay his head down at night. He chose, rather, to live with his people. That's a hard choice to make. But you know what? You and I have to make that choice too. And it's kind of the reverse of what we see with Moses. We can have the opulence and the abounding and the great privilege and the great favor and the great blessing in our life by living for God rather than choosing to live out there in the world of sin. So it's always that choice. Always that choice.
Can
and what's the lesson? Yes, ma'am.
It will disappoint, but to live through Jesus to please Him, we have everything.
Why does the pleasures of life disappoint?
It's not godly.
Temporary.
Not godly.
It's not godly. Temporary, the fading, the no. In fact, we'll see some of the scriptures a little further along from the book of Ecclesiastes, where he says it's all vanity.
Yeah.
Vanity has no value. The pleasures of life.
Cool.
So we understand that we have to make this choice to live. To please God. Who, A says, who are you seeking to please? I want to please God.
Amen.
That's what the aim of my life is, to please God. And that's not always an easy thing because it brings about choices. Number one there under A says, who we please indicates whom we serve.
Yeah.
Think about it like this. Every day when I get up and put my feet on the floor, I want to make Good Robbie happy. I serve her. We serve the ones that we want to please, and we please the ones that we want to serve. That makes sense to you?
Mm-hmm.
I want to serve God, so I want to please God.
Mm-hmm.
I want God to be happy with me.
Mm-hmm.
I want God to bless me and have favor in my life. I want God to protect me. Just like I want Miss Robert to let me sleep in the house at night.
Not with the chickens.
All right, this is all good.
Indeed, I know. I've learned how to choose my words and make sure I go back and replay them.
Because you know, if you serve, you're serving God, and you're serving Miss Robert, it'll help you serve God.
And what does the Bible teach us about a marriage relationship?
Mm-hmm.
It's a relationship of service.
Oh, yeah.
Serving one another. So you see, whom we want to please is going to determine whom we serve. And whom we serve is going to determine who we want to please.
Yep.
I want to please God. Galatians 1 says, for do I now persuade men or God? Mm-hmm. Or do I seek to please men? For if yet I please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. The Bible tells the book of Proverbs that fear of men brings a snare. That means when we're trying to please man, we've got to fear what people think about us and what man thinks about us rather than God. We're liable to get caught up in a trap.
Yeah.
And that trap is pleasing God. I mean, pleasing men.
Yeah.
I mean, you ever heard somebody referred to as a people pleaser?
Mm-hmm.
Meaning that they'll say whatever they need to say to make whoever they're in front of at that time happy. I learned a long time ago, all of my working life, before I was called in ministry full-time, even afterwards, my working life and all the work has always involved people, ministering and kind of like human relations, supervisor type work. And that's all my life is involved around that. And one thing that I learned by looking at the business world as compared to the secular world, in the business world out there, most corporations, and all of you are familiar with this, have what they call a human resources person.
Yeah.
And you know what that human resources person is absolutely good at? Making sure that everybody in the room is happy at the same time. If you got 12 department heads in there and you got a meeting with the plant supervisor and those 12 department heads, that human resources person is the one that has the talent and ability to make sure that everybody is happy all at one time, everybody can leave. That's pleasing people. I'm not casting aspersions on human resource people. That's part of the business world. But what happens if we find ourselves attempting to please people rather than pleasing God? Well, one thing we'll do is we'll end up like a cat on a hot tin roof.
It's exhausting, too.
You know what? Just like a long-tailed cat in a room full of rocking chairs. Everywhere you turn, you're going to get hurt. You're going to hurt somebody's feelings. You're going to get your feelings hurt. And what happens when our feelings get involved? Oh, it gets ugly, don't it?
Mm-hmm.
All logic goes aside. Spiritual discernment goes away. So you see, we've got to learn that our duty is to please God. Does that bring about conflict in our life? Mm-hmm. You bet you it does. You bet you it does. Because the world and those people in the world wants to please them. So when we go to please God, it's going to bring about conflict. And just remember, the fear of man brings a snare, simply means that we can get into a trap by trying to please men and make men happy. Now, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. We're not to go out of here and go into the world and to be abrasive and corrosive. We are to be salt and light. We are to bring change and enhance flavor. And so we're going to be involved, but we're not to go out of here and be ugly and hateful and spiteful and, well, I don't want to be around that person. We are to learn not to please people, but to get along with people. The Bible says in the book of 2 Peter that as much as is within us, we should get along with these people.
Everybody.
So, be careful about that. Number two says, God created us for his pleasure. The whole reason that God created man is to be in fellowship with him.
For him.
For his pleasure. So that he would have someone to fellowship with. That's why the Bible says that God created man in his image. Somebody that was like him. Now, he didn't want fellowship with the donkeys and the goats and the monkeys and the fish and the snakes. No. He wanted fellowship with what he created in his image. That's you and I. For his pleasure. One of the terms that I use a lot of times and is relevant in chaplain work, I serve as a chaplain at the pleasure of, and like with Sheriff's office, I serve at the pleasure of the sheriff. In other words, my role as a chaplain is because he wants me to do what I do, and I serve to please him in that role. I serve in the church at the pleasure of the Lord. I want to please him and be fulfilled in what I do to serve him. So we need to understand that God created us for his purpose, for his pleasure. Notice what it says in Revelation. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Why would it say they are and were created? After finished creating the world, 7 days he rested. But what do we know that is still created? created in the image of God. Humankind.
Oh, yeah.
Babies. Humans are still being created in God's image. And not any more new animals coming about, in spite of what the evolutionists say. And we don't, God just don't pop up there one day and say, hey, I think they need an animal that looks like so-and-so, and bam, there's a new animal. But the Bible says in the book of Revelation, they are and were. Everything that's been created, created for God's pleasure. And still are being created for God. Hey, that should be a thought process for us right there concerning the right to life. Created for God's pleasure. Not our own, by the way. Sometimes we think that I'm out to please myself. That's what I'm about. What does that make us? It makes us self-centered. So, if there are things that please God, and He'll give us some of those things in His Word, there must be some things that displease God, right?
Oh,
it's always a converse to that thought.
Yeah.
So that if there's some things that please God, there must be some things that displease. Number one, under B says, flesh displeases God. Well, why does flesh displease? He created us. He made our flesh. Flesh displeases God. He simply means that when we do things in our own volition, of our own accord, with our own way of thinking. The Bible says there in Proverbs chapter 14, there's a way of seeing right into a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. When we do things in our own thought mind, our own process, what does he tell us over in the book of John? Lust of the eye, lust of flesh, pride of life. We do things the way we want them, when we want them, how we want them, and God is irrelevant. God's displeased with that. And by the way, the Bible teaches us that Book of Romans, particularly, that all flesh is bad.
Yeah.
What does that mean? Does that mean that we're bad? It's not weird for God's servant. But anything that we do in the flesh, that we do with our own strength, is bad.
It's in danger.
Good flesh is bad as bad flesh. All flesh is bad. We should do it under the leadership power of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Romans 8:8 says, so then they that are in the flesh, that are in the flesh, what does that mean? That means that we're walking in the flesh. We're following the ways of the flesh.
Sure.
They that are in the flesh cannot please God. But you're not in the flesh, you're in the Spirit, if so that the Spirit of God dwell in you. We trust Jesus Christ as our Savior. The Holy Spirit lives inside of us now. We shouldn't be doing things in the flesh. We should be doing things in the Spirit. There's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh. See how these scriptures in Romans just keep pounding on this fact that the flesh is not where we're supposed to be at. I mean, what do we say? Sometimes we say kind of tongue-in-cheek, well, I got all flesh here today. Man, I got all up in the flesh. And that's true. We shouldn't be bragging about it, though. Mm-hmm. We should be sorrowful for it.
Yeah.
And repent. When we let the flesh take the lead, when we let our emotions, our mind, will and emotions take the place of what God wants in our life, and we let the flesh lead, then God's not pleased with it. Showing how callous we are at that. When we make jokes about that, we make light of it. And I understand that. We do that amongst ourselves. It's just but it's not, it's really something that we should be shameful for rather than speaking about it. There's therefore who walk not after the flesh. And then there's Proverbs 14 where we mentioned a while ago, there is a way, and talking about a way is a course of life, which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Now, what do we like to do in our own self? We like to figure out the way. Oh, I got it all figured out. I'm going to do like this. I'm going along this way, this course of life. I'm going to make that. And you were talking about that tonight in our praising the Lord time, about how it's an everyday. You know, what we do is we go for great periods of time where we don't recognize God working in our life. And we think, oh, nothing's going on. And then we get to a place that we think is like our crossroads moment, where I got to make this decision. This is a great tumultuous thing. But really and truly, our way, our course of life, we should see God's hand involved in every day. Every day. Right down to the smallest details. You know how you do that? You cast your care upon the Lord. You let Him direct your steps.
Yes.
And that way of life that we think, and now y'all know me, I'm a planner, I'm a facilitator. I look far ahead and make sure we got this and this and this, and we're going to do this, so we need these supplies or these resources. resources. That's me. That's what I do. And that's a very dangerous thing because sometimes the flesh around, I got this all figured out.
Uh-oh.
I know what the way is going to be. But the Bible says that that way of life that I figured out is wrong. And it leads to death. Does it talk about physical death? Well, certainly sometimes it can. The choices we make can lead us, put us in a place where our physical danger. But mostly it talks about, it means that spiritual death. When I'm choosing my way, when I'm following my course of life, when the flesh is large and in charge, guess what? My spirit is to God. It's dead. There's no communication there. You got to open up that channel of communication. So there's nothing that we do in our own self that God's pleased with. And in Proverbs 30 says, there is a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet not washed from their filthiness. Mm-hmm. Paul warns us over the book of Corinthians about comparing ourselves with ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
You know, compared to Randy, I'm a pretty good old fellow. You know, compared to Nick, I'm a number one Christian. In my own eyes, it looks like it's all good, it's all right. That's what he's talking about, this whole generation. And even more so, the generation we see coming along today. Oh, we don't need God, we got it all going on. We don't need God. It says they're pure in their own eyes, but yet they're not washed from the filth. It's in Romans 7, says, for I know that in me, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. But Paul say, I have to mortify the flesh daily. In the book of Colossians, every day I put the flesh to death. I have to kill that joker so that the spirit can shine through. So we see that our flesh and acting in our flesh or walking after the flesh displeases God. How do you know when somebody's displeased with you?
They don't talk to you.
They don't talk to you?
Their looks, their actions.
They give you the stank out?
Cold shoulder.
Cold shoulder. They ignore you. They don't have nothing to do with you. What happens when God's displeased with
us?
He loves us. He watches for us to make. He offers the opportunity for reconciliation and for restoration. See how greater God is than our people that we deal with every day. So our lack of faith displeases God. Not only does our flesh displease God, but our lack of faith. But what's the lack of faith? Because if I'm saved, I trusted Christ as my Savior.
Yeah, we have, and we do.
But what about every day in our life?
That transforming faith. There's two kinds of faith.
Faith that saves us and faith that transforms us. There's faith that is salvation and there's faith that is sanctification.
Yeah.
Every day, God working and changing our life. You know, sometimes our faith won't even get us to the end of the day. I have spelled here a couple of weeks back, last few weeks, 10 days. I was so discouraged and so frustrated and so depressed, I just ain't never going to get no better. Never going to get no better. What was I doing? I was showing my lack of faith. We talked about it in prayer time tonight. Actually mentioned that hope. Reviving our hope. Keeping
Jesus
our hope alive. And see, our faith is what keeps that hope alive. Sometimes we've got to lay it all at his foot and say, God, my faith is weak. What did even the disciples say? Lord, increase our faith. Increase our faith. So our lack of faith displeases God. Hebrews 11:16 says, but without faith it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Yes.
You know, the unsaved people can't please God in any form or fashion. People who never trusted Christ as their Savior can't please God. God can't be happy with them. No matter how much good they do, no matter how many attaboys they get, no matter how many catechisms they memorize, no matter how many candles somebody lights for them, they never trusted Christ as Savior. They can't please God. Because it takes faith. It takes that faith in salvation.
Yeah.
And then every day it takes that faith in sanctification. Being made more in the image of God. Unsaved people cannot please God. The Bible tells us there's none good, no, not one. It also tells us that we all sin, we all fall short of the glory of God.
Yeah.
Deuteronomy 9 says, I was afraid of the anger and the hot displeasure wherewith the Lord was wroth against you to destroy you. Moses went through many times dealing with the nation of Israel, their leader, that he would say to God, what do you want me to do with this disobedient bunch of folks you have given me? That's what he said. And many times Moses also pleaded for God's anger and his wrath not to be shown on the nation of Israel. He pleaded for him. He interceded for him. First Corinthians says, if any man build upon this foundation, remember we talked about this, but we talked about our building our victorious Christian structure. If any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so is by fire. God's pleased with what we do, and when he's pleased with what we do, the things that we do in his name, for his glory, and his honor, will stand the test. But the things that we do for the flesh, and we do to please others, will stand that test. And we'll receive the reward. And finally, Matthew 25 says, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. When God's pleased with us, he'll pat us on the back. When God's pleased with us, he'll scratch us behind the ears. When God's pleased with us, he'll tell us, well done. How comforting is it at the end of the day? You say your prayers, getting ready to go to bed, or you just getting ready to lay down and put your feet up and say, God, thank you for this day. Thank you for leading me today and guiding me today. And he just kind of whispers, you've done a good job today. You haven't been perfect, but you've been consistent and faithful. You've done a good job. Well, that goes a long way.
Yeah, it does.
Goes a long way. It makes you want to get up the next day and work to please him, right? So we want to please God, and pleasing God, and he'll give us in these next few lessons some procedures, some steps, some disciplined things that we do to please him. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this lesson tonight. It speaks to my heart. And Lord, I pray and I know that we all want to please you. All of us here in this room tonight have dedicated ourselves to pleasing you by trusting you for salvation and by trusting you to lead us through the day-to-day workings of our life. And so, God, help us as we start into these few lessons now to notice and recognize these procedures, this method, these steps that we can take, this discipline that we can be involved in that brings pleasure to you. And find us at the end of the day being able to receive those words, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Lord, I pray that you'd help us all be that way. Help us all be that. I'm thankful. I'm thankful tonight for those that are gathered here. And I'm thankful tonight that you are blessing and encouraging in our hearts, even as we gather in these days that seem so chaotic and so hectic and so filled with evil. And Lord, before we leave tonight, we want to mention a special prayer for those families, those children there in Texas, where that evil has pervaded. And Lord, we know that you are the God of all comfort. And you can send the comfort.